Hi everyone, welcome to today's talk on Varta, or like integrating real-time IRC chat on Fedora hubs. So I'll try to set up context for this talk. So once upon a time there was our project called Varta. So it was an attempt to enable online communication and collaboration on top of IRC, giving a nice web user experience similar to other proprietary chatting softwares like HipChat, Slack, etc. And we had a demo instance of it running on fire.varta.com, and we built it on top of node.js, but we ended up building a big monolithic giant, and then we had issues in pushing fixes to it, pushing updates, because all the components are tied into one process, right? We had to restart the entire damn thing to actually push any small fixes or anything. It was not working that great, and then we hit limits of resources until I ran out of money to run the try instances, so I had to just shut it down. And we decided to refactor, break up the entire thing into small pieces and go the microservices way, because that's the hype and that's what the entire container ecosystem encourages to do, and that is good in a lot of ways. And sometime down the line, we started discussing with Fedora. So Fedora's discussing on Fedora hubs, and in the mockup, there was a plan for putting an IRC widget, and we pitched in, and we said that yes, we can empower that, but we need to do a lot of refactor for doing that. And that's how the journey began, moving from the monolithic Varta to microservices.
So let's have a quick look into Fedora hubs. So Fedora hubs was built to have a common platform for the contributors so that they can communicate and collaborate with different tasks, right? So whenever a new contributors come to our like Fedora IRC or mailing list, so the main issue that they faced is a bunch of new tasks or new sets of rules to have made up with. So we came up with this idea called Fedora Hub so that it would be easy for new contributors and even for the existing contributors, so that they can track progress of what things are happening within the hubs. And even with different hubs, like suppose you have in design, so you can even know about what's happening in infrastructure or Relenge or etc. So this is our initial mockup of the Fedora Hubs page. So we have, this is basically the design hub. So in the beginning, in the top nav bar, we have the different hubs, like the design hub, the ambassador hub, the marketing hub, etc. And then below that, we have a small placeholder where it displays all the rules and regulations that needs to be followed. So whenever a new contributor comes, he can like go through the rules and know what it does and what is expected of him. And then we have this widget. So it's like a social network for contributors so that they can collaborate with people and like give their opinions or give status like what they are doing. And on the right hand side, we have, so basically this all are different widgets, and on the right hand side we have like list of contributors in that particular hub who are working. And the main thing is this IRC widget. So in this IRC widget, when you log in, so when you log into hubs, you don't need to have a separate account to log into IRC, so you can directly communicate with the IRC server and write up chat in there, and it would be actually reflected in the IRC channels.
So we had a few requirements on enabling the IRC feature on Fedora hubs. First, it's not like running some web IRC software that is already out there in the market and like putting it on the hub space, right? You would, even after chatting here, you would like to use a favorite IRC client. I use XChat, somebody use IRC, somebody use WeChat. You won't like to give out that experience, right? So you would like to be online from this page and from client as the same nick, right? And so that you can have the continuity of talks in all your clients. So we had to support multiple clients at the same time. And we had to integrate fast auth with the chat software, and we had to make the chat software in such a way that it should not be just a standalone product, but it should be also consumable from a third-party software via API or via deep integration, like directly import that software and use it in an application. So it had to encourage that kind of reusability and extensibility. And when we looked around in the market, we did not find any such library or any such tool which would actually fit all these builds properly. So that's how we started working on our own project. And that's where we started refactoring Varta. So we made a lot of mistakes last time, basically going with the monolithic architecture and building everything into, putting all the pieces into one bucket, and like then yes, it was like difficult to scale and push updates, and also it was difficult to scale the bouncer instance, as in like we, so there's the UI part of the application, right, and there's the bouncer part which connects to the IRC server. Since Freenode puts a lot of restrictions on the bouncer that you can have n number of connections per IP, we need to actually scale that on demand. So if say the n is like 60 users per IP, right, once we exhaust the 60 connections, we need to actually fork another instance of the bouncer on another IP so that we can give the users like a like seamless experience. That did not we could not do with our monolithic thing, because like we had to like deploy multiple instances of that, which would take more memory. And I was running less on servers. I was running the entire system on like two servers, small instances. And it was very difficult to consume that the older Varta either as an API or as a library. We could not do that. And customization, we had to just forget about that thing. So this time, we from the ground up, we started embracing the Unix philosophy: small is beautiful, build small components, which does limited thing, club it together with other pieces, and make it deliver a bigger service. And each service should be standalone in itself, so that we encourage, like, we develop standalone products which talk to each other and deliver the entire story, rather than like building small components which do not have any value independently. So our emphasis was that we build small, usable, standalone products and clump that together to deliver Varta. Microservices. They're cool, yeah. But if not done well, they can be a nightmare as well. And we had our share with it as well. So one of the nightmares is like a syncing state across microservices and how to manage the state, right? We all know that like the REST principle, right? If you're stateless, you can scale indefinitely. But the question is, can applications be state-free? Can they really be state-free? And like, how do you sync states across multiple components, right? So we are pondering upon that issue, and then we came across this concept of like single source of truth. I'll not go into the like topic of like how do we like have redundancy of the single source of truth, but like yes, we need a single source of truth where you dump all the states of the apps, and the apps become stateless now, because all the state has been localized to one component, and now we can scale the apps as needed without worrying about like other things. Because and then it becomes this different topic altogether, how do we scale the single source of truth. But the concept is that like we dump the state to a single component, which may not be a single component physically, but in an abstract way it's a single component, and we make the apps stateless and we scale them easily. And Facebook has been working on this a lot, so they have created a client JS library called React.js, which revolutionizes developing client applications. And they proposed an architecture for developing React applications that's called Flux. So Flux embraces having a unidirectional data flow across the UI components, so that it becomes very easy to maintain states. So Flux goes against the principle of like bidirectional data mediation, where you have got your views, which are dependent on stores, and then they also write to the stores, and the stores, again, they change. So it becomes a chain of cascading changes that keeps on going, and it's very difficult to track the data flow in this model. That's why, like, when we move to a unidirectional data model, which is much functional in nature, you have a clear path of how data flows from a component. So we have got like the OWP or the views here. I'd say call them as views. So views raise actions, or like they're like intents that I want to write some change to the database, right, or the store. And that actions goes through the dispatcher, and then they hit the store. And there's logic written in the store, whether I update myself or not. And when it writes the changes, it emits changes that something has changed. And then it passes through the entire flow and through the views, and the views are listening on that data. If something needs to be, has changed, what they're listening on, they re-render themselves. This is a quite interesting concept, but this was for the client side, for making client side JavaScript apps. A few daring souls have been talking about this, taking this concept to the server side. I read their blogs and I was inspired. And I was also inspired by Fed message, which we have in Fedora ecosystem. I was inspired by a lot of things. And so I tried taking this to the server side, and I built an architecture, something like that. So I replaced, related the microservices that we have similar to the views, right? They are components that depend on the state stored in the stores, right? And they need to do something when the state changes, right? So I kind of like related the web service components with the views, and they want to write something to the database. They raise actions that goes to the dispatcher, hits the store, and the store does the changes, and the store sends or broadcasts change events. And that goes back to the views, but not just the single view, to the entire system. So the entire system is updated about the changes happening in the system. And the same principle we used in developing IRCB. So how I place IRCB is that it's a standalone IRC bouncer made to handle scale. It's not just for setting up an IRC bouncer for my family and friends. It's about setting up an IRC bouncer that can handle huge number of clients and scale as needed. The problems that free node puts some restrictions on the number of connections that I can have from an IP. And whenever some node dies, so I should be able to have multiple instances of this bouncer. And whenever connection comes, the schedule can actually put the bots in the particular bouncer instances so that I run out of that limit late. And as needed, when I reach limit on all the nodes, then I can fork another node and schedule bots accordingly. And if some of the nodes die, then that scheduler has to take those bot instances and put it in the other bouncer instance, or create a new one and put it there. So this is the goal of IRCB. And it is currently a standalone product, as in it's a bouncer. You don't need Varta to use it. It's a bouncer. You just run it. And we are using it inside Varta. But we are publicizing it as a separate product. Like, it's a bouncer which made for scale. And yeah. And it also allows, it has an API built around it. And it also allows, since it's Python, so you can actually access it directly from any Python project and have a hook to the stores directly from the API built around stores. So you can access it via API, or you can directly deeply integrate by import IRCB in your source code and just like start playing with it. So it allows both deep integration and loosely coupled integration. And in IRCB we have emphasized on multiple processes from day one. As in, like, in IRCB the stores run as a different process, the bouncers run as a different process, the CLI runs as a different process, the web server runs as a different process, the log storage backend runs as a different process. But again, we can run all the processes into one, but focus has been given because we need multiple processes and need to have different services which does small things. So we have put that concept from the ground up, so that we build something which is like multi-process and which can be scaled independently. I might need to scale my API server independently of bouncer instances, right? So that's why we have thought about multiple processes from day one. And this is how the architecture of IRCB looks like. So I compared the bouncer processes or the API server and CLI, which are mostly stateless. bouncer is not stateless because it has to maintain the state of IRC connection to the server. I cannot get rid of the state. But all other database and state information that I have are dumped to the store. So I can literally scale them as I need, just like create new instances of that. And I don't need to bother with race conditions, who has got what data, and like creating duplicate instances of bot or not. I don't need to care about that. And they all talk to the store, and no one knows about each other. They all know only one point, the store, which is the single source of truth, right? So they all raise intentions to write to the store, and that goes to the dispatcher, and the store has got all the logic written whether like I'll be writing the changes or not. So if anytime any bug comes in the storage logic, I know that I need to look there, not here. So it has localized my, like, it has separated the concerns, right? Any storage logic is there, and all the like application API server routing logics are here. The bouncer logic is written over there, and CLI is here. So it's a separation of concerns. Debugging is very easy. And when writes happen to the store, it just broadcasts the event, and it goes through all the nodes, and they are listening for the events, just like we listen for fed message events. We have a lot of plugins written on fed message. Same concept. When I say that I was inspired by Flux fed message, yeah, this is how I was inspired. So we all listen for events, and we do things when necessary. For example, I'll give you an example. For example, I create a new network for a user, right? The CLI does that. I enter the values, and it goes to the store. And then the store writes it to the database, and then emits an event that a new network has been added for a user. And that goes to the system. And the bouncer is listening for a particular store added, network added event or network changed event. And then it figures out, okay, is this network something new which I'm not running? If it is not running, it will just create a bot instance for that, connect to the IRC server, or get the bouncer instance for bot instance for the user. Or if it was a change event, it will find out that whether I was running the network for that particular bot for that particular network, it'll kill the bot. It'll again reload the bot on the new network changes, and it'll connect you again with the updated parameters. So this is how simple it is. It did not know about the other components, like the CLI doesn't know about the bouncer. It just does one thing, I add a network. That's all. Similarly, when the CLI can be used to actually disconnect, connect, or like join a channels. It knows nothing about the bouncer. It knows nothing of the IRC protocol. It just writes a DB. It just writes to the DB that, okay, this channel, I want to connect to this channel. And then it goes to the bouncer, and the bouncer does the rest of the thing. Totally decoupled. The API also functions in the same way, similar to the CLI. So, yeah. So this is like unexplored terrain that I'm exploring. It might be a total flop idea as well, but like so far things are working great, and like things look interesting. So the architecture of the entire Varta thing is going to look something like this. We've got multiple IRCB instances, which are the bouncers, right? And again, like we have deeply integrated Varta with IRCB, as in we did not do integration via API. We just imported IRCB stores and we hooked into the stores. So in this system, the beauty of it is that you can plug in, like add and drop any component. It's very easy. Just come and hook to the store and keep writing and listening for events. And that's how you can add any component to that. So we have IRCB on one side, web servers on the other side, which actually powers the web and mobile clients. Mobile clients are not yet there, but conceptually they can be powered easily. And they're all tied up by the store and the dispatcher. And the IRCB instances are connected to the IRC servers. And apart from the web servers, the bouncer instance is also exposed publicly so that you can use a favorite IRC client to connect to the bouncer instance directly via an access token. We take care of the security, so we have an access token system. And another thing and since it is behind the load balancer, we can actually expose the IRC bouncers over 443 or 80 ports, we'll do over 443 to keep it secure, because a lot of public networks do not allow the IRC ports, do not block the IRC ports like 667, 6697, but 443 and 80 are always open. So we can expose the bouncers over those ports, which will be accessible from anywhere, so that you can stay connected from your favorite IRC client wherever you are, maybe airport or anywhere, hotel or wherever. Yeah. So we'd like to show you demo of our current work in IRCB and Varta. So the current state is that we are still working on the UI part. We are trying to fiddle with React.js, Redux. Things are not that smooth for us. So we are in need for contributors and contributions.
So we started, like, we are using Flask for the backend part. So we use the same thing, like use React, because React is powered by Flask, the concept of Flask. So we are also using, for the front end, we are using React. But the thing is, we are both Python developers, and going and doing JavaScript is a bit tough, but we are going there slowly. So the thing is that, like, we are doing it slowly by slowly, and we are looking for contributors who are actually React.js developers, or simply JS developers who are looking to explore more areas into JavaScript. And we are also, like, looking for someone who can help with UI and UX, because that's where IRC lacks a bit, because a new contributor, he kind of feels mismatched with, like, installing XChat or WeChat or IRC or anything like that. So we want to make it literally user friendly, and so
and compete with the proprietary tools in that space, because, like, we find a lot like in our, like, Linux world, nobody cares about the UI. It's all nerds and geeks out there, just terminal. But, like, yeah, you cannot expect that from the new users who are, like, new to the Linux world. You have to be very user friendly and UI focused. So we'll get started with the demo. It's visible, or should I increase the fonts?
It's fine.
Okay. This is difficult.
Yeah.
I'll just sit here. So I'll clean the slate right now. I'll do RM. Where am I? Web app, RCB. DB. Just done that. So I'll start for the IRC bouncer instance. So I'll start it on port 11,000, and I'll start it in a mode which is all in one. So I'll start all the components that I spoke of, like, they can run as different services, processes, but I'll, for sake of...
So you can do actually do IRCP run stores, IRCP run server separately, but here we are doing it all in one, so that it will start all the processes in one go.
So there'll be a traceback. Yeah, I need to look into that, but it's not a blocker. And I'll start our web app. App.py, right?
Yep.
And I'll start our application which renders the client JavaScript client user interface. Yeah, so everything is running, the three processes, right? So let me open demo.varta.com. So this is a local, it's not public, it's a local setup I've done behind my Nginx. The concept is that we're sharing. So the chat application is under chat.varta.com, and this is under demo.varta.com, so that they're sharing the same domain, so that we can share cookies across the domain. So it's replicating the Fedora Hubs use case, as in, like, in Fedora Hubs, there will be, like, chat.federaproject.org and hubs.federaproject.org. So that when you're logged in inside federaproject.org, you're automatically logged in inside the chat application for your fast account information. So I'll create a user, because I've deleted my database. So I'll try to go, like, rtmpro, password, and I'll give my email. Yep, so it's asking me to add a network. Let me try. Okay, I'll add Freenode. Yeah, that's our favorite network. And chat.freenode.
free node .net. And connected over in secure port because I'm not sure of this SSL things yet. And let me choose Nick. W. And let me join Fedora Hubs, right? Fedora Hubs. Hash. Is that a dot or a comma?
I can't tell.
It
looks like a dot to me.
Yeah, and now it's okay. And this is our playground where we do all the nasty things on IRC. Okay. All the testing basically. So, yeah. So, we see the network list. So, we have a network has been created in our database. And I see the channels that have already operated to join. And I see access token. I'll come that in a bit. I'll try to. Okay, I can just click it here. Yep. So I see that like this is a sample page with no background. Like it's just a dummy page which basically replicates that a Hubs page, for example, designs, right? And it is mapped to, for example, here the channel is BCREC, right? So it is mapped to the BCREC channel in the IRC, right? So I can go and speak here. Is my internet disconnected? I believe so.
Try to go to the web page.
I think I need to restart my. Let me see. Oh, no, it's not.
Was that cached?
Could be. Let me see. RAC. I was doing some testing sometime back. Let me start the services again. It seems to connect. Maybe my I'll restart my chat. So yeah. Where is the browser? Yeah. So okay. Yeah. So let me type a message. Let me try to. Did I not get the message here?
So
the message was sent. Something wrong with this client. It's not fixing these as well. Okay. I'm not getting any of the messages here. How would it be different?
This
is all in the UI. Can I speak there? Yeah, I'm getting messages. Did you get ping, Dusty? On Fedora Hubs?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
we are getting the messages here. There's some problem with the integration of the client application that we are using. But the concept is something similar that we go to a page and we automatically log in the user to this external chat application, and we talk here in the widget. The UI obviously you have to integrate like, but this is a third party tool. We are using something called Launch or like Shout. We just tweaked it and like use it for the UI for the demo, and the real chat client is work in progress. As he said that we're stuck with the Redux and re-exist stuff. Yeah, so this is one bit of it. Let me go back. So here's the access token, right? What is this for? This is actually connecting from any other client to the IRC bouncer directly. So what I'll do is that I'll go to XChat and I'll try to create a new network. Add, right? Yep. So RCP demo. Edit. And here I'll paste the server password, the access token basically. And thanks. And here I'll give the IP, so it is like 127.0.0.1/11000, correct?
Yeah. Yep.
I'll close it and I'll connect to it. Yes, I'm on the two channels that are joined from there as well. BCRC and Fedora Hubs. And I can type
poor guy.
Yeah, but the beauty of this is that typically in when you are connected to bouncers, right, when you type from one client, the other client does not get this message because it's an external message from you. You don't get it back. I hacked our like ICB before this demo so that like if I open my message was just sent to Dusty, right? That came back here as well. So it gets like reflected from the bouncer back to the other client. So I check the siblings, how many siblings I'm having, and I just send it to all which are not me. So yeah, this is a cool small feature, like not a big deal, but like yeah, as to the user experience. So you have got the same set of logs in your IRC XChat and in your web chat widget as well. Yeah, so this basically ends the demo of Varta. Yeah.
Can you show us private messages?
Oh, private message, there's a bug, but I can show you private messages. Where is that? Where's my cursor? Yeah. Sorry. Yes. Did you get the message? Did you get it now?
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, there's a bug in this client tool that we are using. So it's a single word, it somehow doesn't send it to the server. But yeah, multiple word it sends.
Yeah,
so
did this pop in XChat too?
Yeah. So it's popped in XChat as well. Here, where is it? Yeah. Dusty has said. So yeah. But I could not figure out that broadcasting thing in the personal messages because there's a quirk to it, as in like the name that comes here, like the Dusty Mape that who has sent the message. This comes from the mask, the IRC mask that gets into the raw message, right? So I tried doing the same thing for PMs, but what happens is that like when I'll be reflecting it back. Even the messages I send will be coming under Dusty Mape's name because like it takes a mask and a two, right? So when I'm sending the two as me and the mask as me, then all the messages will be coming as me. And if I send the mask as Dusty's, all the messages will be coming from Dusty's. So that's a kind of like, but anyways, I think we'll figure that out. We have to do some hack around that, but like, yeah. So that's the current limitation of the PM having consistent message logs throughout the chat clients. and yeah, so yes, yeah. So that ends the demo and current state of things, as in like, so we are working on the Redux application. We are kind of stuck and like we need some resources, but we'll get, we have gotten through worse scenarios before as we'll get, we manage things out.
And the thing is that like we are also planning to use, like right now Fedora Hubs is also using React.js for actually the feed, and slowly we'll be migrating most of the UI to React.js. So that would be helpful. So yeah, so we are looking for contributors of Fedora Hubs also.
It's I don't know how to say it, so please do not misunderstand. When the people were talking about Fedora Hubs, it's said people, the users don't want to register anymore to the mailing list. They want a new way of communication, and they want something new. Is why are you spending so much time making connection with IRC, which is the archetype of the past? That is something that works, that is robust, but is the archetype of the past, for Fedora Hubs, when we know that you can use XMPP, that every single user of Fedora has an alias, an open ID, and that you can connect. There is already a brand connection between IRC and XMPP, and we also can publish content with XMPP, we can secure things, we can make a multiple account connection, and instead of using Telegram for a flock or a Fedora event, you can just create a new discussion room on XMPP. So I'm very surprised, because it sounds like something so difficult to do with IRC, which is not my way of thinking of new way of communication between users. IRC as a newcoming for since 1 year, it's the place of ghost, where sometimes you find the white knight who saves you because you need help, and at this time there's a poor user coming and helps you, but most of the time it's ghosts. So it's why did you make that thing that is very technically advanced? It's not easy to do, and it works, so it's an achievement in itself. But why didn't you choose something that's already that the XMPP,
Jabber, for example? So initially our thing was that, first thing, IRC for open source communities, at least I think IRC is not going to go away, it's going to stay, but yes, though the possibilities of having like more higher, like high level communication aggregators like Jabber or XMPP, and if we can integrate that with IRC, that could be a good way to go ahead. And since our like bouncer is totally decoupled, so we just like we ported our code from the previous instance to this and got the bouncer up. But since it's totally decoupled, right, we can easily rewrite the bouncer component without touching the rest of the.
Have a separate XMPP bouncer.
Yeah, because like the trouble with the IRC is that it does not like, we have to do a lot of like wrappers around that to actually empower a good IAM experience, because IRC is not meant for instant messaging, right? So like Jabber works perfectly for that, and Jabber is, I think, a superset of IRC protocol, like RSVP.
IRC is not meant for instant messaging. It's amazing. It's just
for what? No. By instant messaging, I mean the cool instant messaging service right now. Like you have those kind of like events, like you see someone typing, like someone's typing something, right? Those other things, those are not supported by IRC, right? Like someone is typing a message, or like other cool things that you see in Facebook chat, and
there's no metadata.
Yeah. And even IRC messages don't even have timestamps. When you're running an IRC service for many people, and you are
so why IRC? Why are you basing your instant messaging on Fedora Hubs and IRC?
That's
where
the community is.
Because
they're going. For the community.
Because we do not want to build something which will also not work with other IRC clients, because we have to empower, like, keep the other IRC clients working. So we can add a lot of metadata in the IRC messages. We can do that. And to support various features in with the web, right? But what about the other people who are still using IRC? What about the people who are still using XChat? So we don't want to break that compatibility, right? Because we don't want to make people move to another tool like Slack or something which is a proprietary new protocol. We don't want to do that. We want to build an awesome user experience on the things that we have.
Yeah.
But if feature needs us to evolve, we can easily do that since our like company is like micro, everything is separate service. We just need to rewrite the bouncer component without touching the rest of the things. That room is there to evolve. But since the entire community, open source community, there, is there on IRC, right? So we are trying to have, we are not doing anything extra which IRC and IRC clients will not support.
Yeah. But I think that people use IRC because there's nothing else. It works fine,
yes.
It's robust. It's exists and there's multiple ways to connect, but it's just an
because it's the only way out there to communicate right now.
Yeah, nobody tried to push anything else.
So if people come up with a different communication media, like say if like Jabber or like SMPP becomes mainstream, which did not become yet, we can support that. But like currently, since IRC is the thing out there. And I feel that people are moving away from IRC only because of the user experience and this lack of seamlessness.
Mostly they like move away to Slack because they have this beautiful experience and so.
And they can get, even like we do not have good IRC mobile plans. We have got IRC cloud plans, which is again a proprietary solution, right? We do not have good open source solutions for IRC clients as well.
And
so
that, because like React, because the, one of the main motive of using React is that they have React Native, which is helps us to like port to mobile.
So previously people have tried to write one single code base for multiple devices. It did not work for anyone of them because HTML does not run as fast as native application. So React.js has this concept called React Native, where you use the same concepts of React, the React paradigm, and you write native code, but in the same pattern, so that you do not need to learn new concepts. You can write native apps the way you write web apps, but in native language. So it runs fast. There's no like abstract, like unnecessary like, compilation done and all. So it runs as native code. So the point is that we will be working on native clients as well. But first, we need to get up with this. But obviously, the thing is that if the community agrees on other protocols, right, we'll choose whatever protocol the community works like uses.
I don't think the community agree or don't agree. I don't remember seeing someone who asked the community about, hey, do you think it's a good idea to use Telegram for Flock? It's just they took the tool and the user came, and that's it.
Because Flock is
because
Telegram is seamless to use. The experience of Telegram is like very seamless, right? That's the reason why people.
It's way better.
Yes, that's what it's seamless, like.
Way better.
So people go for the seamless experience. So our target is that if we can provide the seamless experience on top of IRC, why won't people stick with IRC?
We are already there on IRC. So if we the thing only missing is the seamless feature. So if we move like IRC to that particular point, so why not stick to IRC?
Yeah. So for example, we're all in IRC already.
Yeah.
Or sorry. A good number of us are in IRC already, you might not be. But if we could have a very good mobile client for IRC where you can send a link to somebody and they click on it, it automatically adds you to the chat just like it did for Telegram, then I believe that we would actually be there instead of Telegram right now on our mobile client, right, on our phones.
The problem is the account creation. On Telegram, you don't need to create to have an account. It's already connected to your contact.
Do you need an account for IRC?
Yes, we need one. We need to create one.
No,
we
just
unfriend. I need it.
Maybe for certain channels, you don't have to create an account. Like he just joined with RTM Pro -W.
That's
not an account.
That's normal. Like,
it's just if you want to reserve your.
Yeah, just so some channels don't let you log in unless you have an account to get rid of people that are like you know bothering.
Spammer,
basically. But
with the Fedora Hubs use case, you're already connected. Or how do you?
Right, so in that
connected, so you already you open an ID connection, so there's no account problem anymore because it's always the same account for your whole Fedora activity. So you can already connect yourself to an XMPP server or something else. So
and
here no
server, in this case is IRC server, because like we are all talking us. So with the Fedora account information, right, you can even automate the like registering the user with the IRC server, but there are various security issues with that, because IRC is a protocol that works on raw text. So if you have to auto-identify a person via the server, the server will know the password. That is one of the biggest challenges with IRC. The reason being, like, IRC was designed way back where this kind of issues did not exist, but like still like people are using IRC. So that is our bottleneck, right? Because people are using IRC and we want to make the, so that is a kind of like assumption we have made, that we are building a tool for IRC. We are not reinventing a new protocol, because we know that the community will keep on speaking on IRC.
It exists.
Yeah, but like community is using IRC.
Like,
that's why
for
we
example,
are on IRC.
I'm on Fedora. I want to republish one command on another platform.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's already some connectors that exist between XMPP and Diaspora and Facebook and stuff like that,
mm-hmm.
you can republish it. And if you want to handle that communication by yourself without using an existing protocol, you will have to be able to.
That we can,
it's
we,
going to
we
be
can like the library we are using for IRC implementation, is say like it allows awesome plugins you can build around that. So I think plugging in XMPP or other protocols with that won't be that difficult. Like at the end, like we have to take that message and like hit other servers, right, and send that to other places. So that won't be difficult. We'll be having various plugin system, but we're just like currently focusing on like building this basic use case and then focus on like implementing other plugins.
On the
but
long run, like we have like set up, like you can like upload to Google Drive or Pastebin, like which are not there, like they are not in the IRC protocol, but there will be plugins within Vartha, so that you can do all this operation. So
IRCB is just an IRC bouncer. It's just an IRC bouncer. And now we're developing Vartha as a layer on top of that to give you that other good, to have the other features that enables a good user experience on top of IRC, similar to other IRC, popular IRC, not IRC, like chat clients, like Facebook or
mm-hmm.
like Google Hangout. But yes, we are aware of those things, that they're like better protocols than IRC, but yes, we have decided to stick to IRC for now. If needed, we'll evolve, but like for now, we're building it out of the IRC. That's the decision we have taken. Yeah.
I mean, basically what it comes down to is you either have to choose and make everybody move to a new client, right? Or you need to build something that bridges the gap, which is what they're trying to do, right?
They're trying to glue the differences. Right?
So like, you're never going to convince everybody to move away from IRC.
Because it's not just the Fedora project, it's people that are contributing to multiple other projects out there.
Yeah,
you can get hundreds of other projects to say, okay, you guys are moving to XMPP, so you have to have all the other projects move there anyhow, and then they're already connected to IRC for those. So.
But like, if you have the bouncer that already exists, XMPP to IRC, the end user don't even know he's not using XMPP or IRC. It's
the folks using the web interface. I don't know that. The folks that are still
yeah.
directly to the bouncer with their XChat, they know.
Yeah, so like for example, I use a terminal IRC client, and I like that. I like actually using a terminal IRC client. I don't want to use a web browser to access IRC.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I want to continue to be able to do that. However, when I'm moving around, a web client on my phone would actually be really nice. So having something that bridges those two worlds.
The bouncer will talk to the XMPP. And when you will be on your Android client, it will bounce to your IRC account. And the XMPP will manage the multiple devices, whatever way you are on the different. There's huge possibilities with XMPP that I just know as a user.
Mm-hmm.
And it will offer the new experience that users are looking. That's why they are using Telegram here for Flow.
Mm-hmm.
And still having the connection with the people who want IRC in a common client, okay, if you want to use it, no problems at all.
I think
I don't know enough about XMPP.
I think we did not do much research on XMPP, so I think we need to go and look up into XMPP.
Yes.
Like, does implementing an XMPP like bounce into this bouncer becomes like bottleneck for using it as just IRC? If it's a superset and if it allows other features that a modern chat client needs.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll look into it. Like, we need to explore because, like, considering
XMPP is a great technology, right?
Yeah.
I'm not arguing with you, but I think what they're doing here is completely valid.
Thank you guys,
because I've been.
It's a huge amount of work.
I've been eyeing IRC Cloud longingly, but unwilling to pay the money.
Well, it sounds like what he's saying is that they could use XMPP for pretty much everything except the connect with your IRC client, but he's saying that they could. There's also a bridge that you can use with XMPP, so that you can still do that.
I've never seen a Java client that did anything close to a good job of handling group chats.
Yes. So I don't know.
XChat and the console based IRC clients are the only things I've ever seen that are tolerable for dealing with things that are focused on channels, right?
Right.
I mean, XMPP is great for.
Yeah.
Or just in messages, you know, you and one, maybe two people, but you know, when there's 100, 200, 1,000 people on a channel, no.
Yeah. So I don't know, maybe it could work.
I think it's worth exploring whether like we can improve the client, because like on top of this raw IRC, we have gone and do a lot of work on that. If XMPP helps, well and good, we have to go and explore, because we have not done our homework on XMPP, so we need to go and explore.
Right.
It
so
helps.
If you know a lot about XMPP, so maybe you can join Fedora Hubs and chat with these guys.
In fact, in France, there's a website and there's some developers of XMPP platforms, and they are publishing. They are explaining how the XMPP work and the basics and protocols and the different layers. And they did. So I read this article. It's one good example.
Right.
So I know the possibilities of XMPP, but I'm not a developer myself.
Yeah.
I'm a translator.
Okay.
So it's just I see that most of what you want to achieve sounds achievable and existing in protocol.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like because of the dozens of articles that exist. But sometimes your article says something and the technical says something else. And maybe indeed there's no client that exists. But
which isn't a
fault
with the protocol.
So have a look and test if it exists, it makes your life
easier.
and your goal more achievable, because it's a huge work and it looks difficult to do.
I think one of the biggest problems with all the other solutions for this are that other people are looking for a solution and they take XMPP, whereas there are certain requirements for these communities,
mm-hmm.
which are maintaining feature parity with people that want to continue to use IRC, and knowing that the communities are going to be there. So it might require a new project, such as this, that has those things, those goals in mind.
Yeah.
But the new project, good. If we could use XMPP, great. As long as the
it's
goals of the project are achieved,
which
means I can continue to do this and I don't even know anything changed, that's great. And then also people get their feature-rich interface as well.
Yeah. So
that would be great.
It's worth a look to have a dive into XMPP and see how it kind of like fits into our like ecosystem to solve the problem.
Right.
Yeah, because we have to do our research on that.
The great thing, the two big features I think are presence, you know, knowing if somebody's there and somebody's sending a message, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And also, and the one problem you have with IRC, with an exchanging.
Because those kind of things,
right.
If I have to do it on top of just pure vanilla IRC, I have to do a lot of hacks. And like, I have to, but if XMPP supports that, then that'll be damn easy, because I know XMPP already supports that it shows the message of like somebody's typing, somebody came in. So if that is already handled by XMPP and like, that XMPP to IRC bounce, which you talked about, if it is a valid bridge between XMPP and IRC, I think it's worth giving a look. And as I said, like, it will not affect our UI anyway, because it's totally decoupled. So it will just clean.
Is there your mail address somewhere so we can reach you?
Yeah, is it there? It's not.
Got it.
Yeah.
So how would the implementation exactly look for, so you've got hubs up here, you've got a set of users that are logged into Freenode or something like that, and then you have people on XMPP, they're choosing the XMPP client, so the question is like, how do those users get into Freenode? Would they appear in that user list? That would require a whole lot of...
At the end, there has to be a bot running in some server which connects you as you to the IRC server, and you connect by the XMPP to that thing, and that's, there's some bridge that like, forwards a message from here to here and takes your message from here.
So on IRC, you have all your messages being like proxied by some box. But say this guy over on XMPP sent you a message and says this.
Even from here in port, right? It is some an application running on some server, right? So your messages are going through some server. What you can do is that, yeah. What you can do is that, I've done construct the recording.
Yeah.